Well, 2016 was a huge year in a lot of different ways. Obviously, the kind of pinnacle was a sad week, but it was a celebratory week as well, and that's when Muhammad Ali passed and really gave the city a platform to show itself off to the world. And normally when the world is transfixed on a city, it's some kind of tragedy or dark side, but this was a week of celebrating the champ, of love and compassion, and seeing the city come through for that and how it culminated with his procession through town. It was really just exceptional. So you've got that really is a once in a couple hundred years kind of thing. And then you've got big events like the Ohio River Bridges project being completed 40 years to get it started. But boy, once it got started, we got that thing done in 3 to 4 years, and it's a beautiful project. We've got $9 billion of capital construction going on in the city right now, so it's hard not to see the progress taking place. And I'm really proud of the people development that we've had this year. Almost 45% of Louisville's adults now have a college degree. The national average is 42%. 10,000 people worked themselves out of poverty. 60,000 new jobs in the last 5 years. So there's a huge amount of momentum going on in our city.
Do you feel like Louisville is doing as well in the economy in 2016 as other cities, or better? Where do you think it stands in terms of its economic growth?
Yeah, data shows that we're running a little bit above national average as it relates to our economic growth. Now, when you take a look at our last 5 years, we're outpacing most all American cities right now. So we've got a lot of momentum right now. And again, you can see that by the amount of investment that's taking place in the city. That investment is not just local folks, it's people from out of town as well. So a lot of people are placing big bets on our city. And you can just kind of feel that momentum. So our economic development strategy is working as well. So it's a long slog, if you will, but you're seeing an increase in our median wage for the first time in a long time as well over these last 3 years. So things are looking very positive.
But for us, though, we see every week we're covering 1, 2, 3 homicides a week now. This has been a year of a lot of violence. When you think about all the violence that has been happening, you're just thinking about it personally. Yeah. What do you think about?
Well, this is kind of the struggle when you're running a big city like we have. You've got all this great news that's taking place, and then you have the tragedy that takes place as well. And it's no secret that the last 18 to 20 months, we've seen a significant uptick in violent crime in our city. The irony, of course, is the amount of resources that our city and cities all over the country right now are placing on homicide reduction is at an all-time high. But the results are still elusive. So it's difficult from obviously one, a personal perspective, in that there is tragedy behind each one of these deaths. It's difficult for me personally and for this office in that this job consumes you. I mean, it's a 24/7 job. So it's the last thing that I think about when I'm going to sleep at night and checking public safety issues. And then if I'm not woken up during the night by something related to it, it's the first thing that I check as well. And then you think about all the families that are involved with this and neighborhoods where they're hearing way too many gunshots that are taking place and a feeling of frustration by many folks of why aren't we seeing better results? And then how do I get involved? And then a feeling of frustration at the neighborhood level where some people are afraid to get involved as well. So this is a problem, you know, fueled by illegal drugs, way too many guns on the streets, people fighting for territory. All I can guarantee folks, and anybody that's honest, if they guarantee a certain result by a certain date, they're lying to you. But what they should be able to tell you is whatever it takes, we're gonna continue to work on this 24 hours a day. You can expect that type of effort from us, LMPD, and here's how we need the community involved as well. So it takes everybody.
I know it's hard to measure results right away, but what do you think are the most effective things that the mayor's office did in 2016 to combat both violence and heroin epidemic?
Well, what I'm pleased about with some of our violence reduction outcomes is what we're seeing from our reentry and our reimage programs, where we've partnered with young folks that have been court involved that said, I don't want this life of drugs and crime anymore. I want to get my degree, I want to get a job. So we're seeing scalable results in those areas now. So we see when we apply resources specifically, we can get results. Those are examples where it's one person at a time that works. As it relates to the opioid problem and heroin, the results that we're getting out of our jail with our Enough is Enough program, where people are arrested and are in addiction phase, to move them through that, dry them out, get them sober, and then see them continue on a pathway of sobriety, that's working as well. So there's no question that there's things that are working. The challenge is, how do you scale these up so that they're working to the maximum extent that they can? So it's a manpower issue. It's also learning. We're learning fast along this way. And we are making results. But when you see these headline kind of crimes, you know, like a homicide, people shake their head and say, there's another one. The facts are, these are, unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, they're very geographically concentrated. They're not affecting our entire city as well. And that's where you really, your heart goes out for these neighborhoods that are affected by this, because they are, you know, they are populated by 99.9% of the people that are just trying to live. And they live in these intense areas where there's too much crime, too much poverty, too poor of health outcomes. That's why you see us trying to disrupt concentrated neighborhoods of poverty. That's why the Russell Neighborhood Choice Neighborhood grant was so important here at the end of the year. It's going to lever up into a $200 million project where Russell will be made into a mixed use, mixed income, multi-generational neighborhood, break up concentrated poverty. That's another way that you can make progress in this area.
Are you worried that all this violence and these headlines about violence are eclipsing the good things that are happening in the city in terms of economic growth?
Well, it's a struggle when you have a city this size. You're going to have all kinds of good things going on. And then if you've got an honest group in the mayor's office, they're also going to be talking about the challenges that are going on. And people have to be able to live with that kind of ambiguity. When you look at the city, there's no question it's going through a transformation. You see all the construction that's going on. You see 30,000 open jobs that are taking place. But the daily reporting of crime is like a drip on the community. So we're living in a really complex world right now, both internationally and domestically and locally. And so you've got to say, how does it affect me? How can I move forward and kind of get through all the noise that takes place relative to all these different media channels that we've got right now? So what you've got to do is be positive and keep growing and accenting all the good things that are going on in the community. And you've got to work on the things that are detracting us from being the greatest at the same time. So when I talk to folks, they seem to have that kind of awareness, and they also seem to understand that fighting violent crime is not easy. They read in the paper and they see, you know, this past weekend what happened in Chicago with, you know, 50 gunshots, 11 homicides, and saying, thank goodness we're not that city. So there's an awareness that this is not just a local problem, but that doesn't make it any easier for the families that are involved with this.
Muhammad Ali is one of the biggest stories.
Yeah.
What do you think Muhammad Ali, if he was alive today, and of course if he could speak, what do you think he would say about the number of homicides?
He would be disgusted by it. And really, that's one of my real regrets, that Muhammad is not alive and healthy today to be that model for so many neighborhoods of our city that need a model like him, that understood what makes somebody great is the road work, as he used to say, the practice that makes you great, but beyond that, who you are. And that's what the Ali Center stands for, that's what the CHAMP stood for in terms of spirituality, conviction, giving. It was about other people and helping them to their pathway to greatness. His message is a message that we try to accentuate every day through our city value of compassion, of saying that, look, the thing that binds us together are these human values like compassion, kindness, and love. It's not the violence that tears us apart. So the CHAMP obviously would be fighting against violence in our urban areas with all his heart if he was still capable of that. So we need to be able to take his spirit and put that to work in the city and hope that folks that are involved with this really evil part of our society wake up and say, this is not a way to go forward. The CHAMP certainly would not approve.
I met reporters from Ireland, from Asia, from all over the world. All eyes were on Louisville. How do you think Louisville looked to the world that week?
It was a world-class week for us to honor a world-class guy. What I was so proud about was Cassius Clay, 3302 Grand Avenue, Muhammad Ali. When people saw him as the world's greatest athlete, and he certainly was. But what we saw as his life evolved was that was a platform that he created so he could be the world's greatest humanitarian. And what I so love about that is that not everybody's going to be the world's greatest athlete, but everybody can be a humanitarian. And that's what we really focus on when we talk about compassion. These are the things that bring a city together. And that's what we saw during that week, how all of Louisville celebrated the champ. And when his procession went through town on those 19 miles on the final day before he was laid to rest at Cave Hill, that was really one of the proudest, well, that was the proudest moment I've had as mayor, I can tell you that. Because you saw people come out and they identified with Muhammad as their neighbor, their uncle, somebody that they wanted to be like. It was incredible. So normally when the world is focused on a city, there's some kind of tragedy taking place. The world focused on our city for a week of love and compassion and greatness, really celebrating through our son. That was really something to have. He's from Louisville. He's our guy. He belonged to the world, but he only had one hometown.
And I really only have one thing left to wrap up with. We talked a lot about Muhammad Ali. We talked a lot about the violence, unfortunately, and a little bit about the economy. When I asked a couple of people even what they thought were some of the biggest stories, the bridges came up a lot.
Yeah.
This was the year that two bridges opened.
Yeah.
In Jefferson County. What are those bridges going to mean for Louisville in the long term?
Well, I'm really proud of the whole bridges project. Obviously, it took 40 years before it got started, which is a whole other story. But the way that project started off, too expensive, and it was value engineered down. Great work by both the transportation cabinets in Indiana and Kentucky and Walsh Construction and all of the cities involved with it to get it to a point where we could afford it. It's going to unlock our economy even but more than so than what it is right now. And then it's going to relieve a lot of congestion and traffic that's been going on in the city as well. So, you know, it's a project that if we didn't have to do it, it was great, but we had to because of all the congestion involved. So it's going to make our regional economy more productive than what it has been.
There's actually one more question that I forgot to ask you, and I hate to go back to the violence part of it. But on CBS this morning, they had a story about Chicago, and they were interviewing police officers. And these officers were talking about how they felt like morale in the Chicago Police Department was at an all-time low. In recent weeks, the FOP president has also expressed similar concerns about officers and what we gave them. What can the mayor's office do, or what does the mayor's office plan to do to improve morale?
Well, morale is something that's controlled by an individual. And I can tell you when I talk to LMPD officers who, you know, their best day is oftentimes people's worst day. I mean, this is the reality that they work with. These are dedicated folks that are giving it their all for our city. So what they tell me is we just want to do our job. They don't want to get sidelined by any kind of comments. They just say, let us do our job. I say, do you have all the gear that you need? We got the gear. Let's just get to work. So morale and attitude is something that's controlled at the individual level. And I can tell you in my dealings with LMPD, these folks are getting after it every day. And when people have an opportunity to thank them, they should thank them. When they see an opportunity to improve LMPD, I'm proud of them that they're able to embrace that as well. We got a fine police department here in Louisville that gets after it every day.
Do you think there's a morale problem at LMPD then? Do you think
you know, the FOP speaks for a small part of LMPD. The LMPD officers that I work with, the FOP is one part of LMPD. I talk to officers on the street every day. They talk to me about them just wanting to do their job. And morale, attitude is a very subjective thing. It's controlled by the individual. So when you get up in the morning, no matter where you go to work, you're the one that makes the decision about that. And I can tell you in talking to our officers that I consider amongst the finest in the country, these are people that are getting after it every day.